Today is the 20th day of the 10th month on our Maker's restored calendar. It is the 23rd day of the 12th month on His servant Satan's calendar. Today the Most High is going to reveal to you a pair of incredible magnifications of His instructions for us to not seethe a kid of a goat in its mother's milk. The first of the three places that He gave us this instruction is in Exodus chapter 23. I'll begin in verse 19. You shall go to Yahweh Elohim's house with the first of the firstfruits of your land, and you shall not seethe a kid in its mother's milk. Yahweh gave us this instruction this first time right after He gave us His instructions for all males to appear before His face three times a year on His three harvest feasts. And He did so right before He called His servant Moses up Mount Horeb for the first 40 days. The obvious part of this commandment is for us to obey it literally, and do not seethe a kid of the goats in its mother's milk on a physical plane. But does it also mean what Judaism's perversions of His word tell us that it means? Those in Judaism claim that it means that we cannot drink milk or eat or drink any dairy products in the same meal that we eat meat. On the authority that Yahweh Elohim's word gives to me, I can assure you that this is not what this instruction means. Yahweh went on in the next verse to tell us in verse 20, Behold, I have sent my messenger before your face, and I will hedge about you in the way, and you will come to the place that I have prepared for you. Is it a random thing that the Most High tells us to come to the place that He has placed His name three times a year, and then He tells us to come to His house with the first of the first fruits of our land, and then in the same sentence He tells us to not seethe a kid of the goats in its mother's milk? Is it just a random thing that then He goes on to tell us that He sent a messenger before our ancestors' face to lead them into His promised land? The King James translators translated the word for messenger in this verse to be an angel. And sometimes this is the Hebrew word that refers to an angel, but not always. The next verse testifies that this is not the case in this verse. In verse 21, hedge about him and hearken to his voice. And do not grieve him, because I will not lift your rebellion if you do, because my name is in his inward parts. The messenger that Yahweh was speaking about in these verses is His servant that He drew out from the water. He also sent an angel before their faces to hedge about them. However, He did not speak to them through this angel. He did not tell them to obey an angel's voice. He told them to obey His messenger Moses' voice. Verse 22, Because if you will diligently obey, or hearken to His voice, and do all that I speak to you through my messenger, then I will be an enemy unto your enemies, and I will besiege your afflictions. Yahweh's servant that He drew out from the water was His messenger during the days of the first Exodus. Moses was His spokesperson. But so often our ancestors did not hearken to Yahweh's word that was upon him, and they all died in the wilderness except for their children, and except for Joshua and Caleb and their families. His word tells us that He has sent me to you in the manner that He sent His servant Moses to our ancestors. He has sent me to you with His name in my inward parts. But you have not diligently hearkened to that which the Most High has spoken for you to do through His messenger. You have not hedged about His messenger of His covenant that He has sent to you at this time. Nearly all of you refuse to even sustain His messenger and the place that He has placed His name at this time, like He commands you to do. At least our ancestors did so with His messenger and the place that He had placed His name at that time. Even though they murmured against His servant that He drew out from the water those 10 times, and even though they lifted themselves up before Moses' face, at least they brought that which Yahweh had given to them to Yahweh to set up His dwelling place in the wilderness. This is recorded in Exodus chapter 35, verse 29. And every man and woman that had willing hearts came unto Kikweh with all of the work that Kikweh had commanded or enjoined to them by the hand of Moses, his servant that he had drawn out from the water, to do. And the children of Israel came unto Kikweh with free will offerings. The Most High sent me to you with what causes him to turn our baptism waters into his only begotten Son's shed blood? In lieu of this, in a similitude of drawing his servant Moses out from the water, he also drew me out from the water. He did so by turning my baptism water into his only begotten Son's shed blood. Yet you have not obeyed his charge to hearken to that which he has spoken through me. You have not obeyed his charge to stand with and to sustain his servant that he has sent to you, bearing his name at this time. In chapter 36, verses 5 through 7, we are told that our ancestors came to Kikweh with more than what was needed to set up his house, and his servant that he drew out from the water had to tell them to stop bringing to him. Contrast this with the here and the now, where almost none of you have brought to his house that which he has enjoined for you to bring to him at this time. And on top of this, in the beginning of him sending me to you, I told you to not send your tithes and your offerings to his servant, but rather to use them to cry aloud and to spare not with me in order to warn others to turn from their rebellion to him. But nearly all that heard did nothing to do so. And since he has led me to tell you to bring your tithes and your offerings into his storehouse at this time, nearly all have continued to fail to do so. Therefore, since you have refused to diligently hearken to his voice by coming unto his house and offering freely unto him, he is going to cause your gold and your silver to be worthless to you, along with everything else that you think that you own. He is going to show you that he owns even the air that you breathe. The other two places that his word tells us to not seethe a kid of the goats in its mother's milk are in Exodus chapter 34 and in Deuteronomy chapter 14. When he does so in Exodus 34, Kikweh repeats the same word that he spoke to us through the hand of his servant in chapter 23. He does so in verse 26. You shall go to Kikweh Elohim's house with the first of the firstfruits of your land, and you shall not seethe a kid in its mother's milk. Here these instructions also follow him, telling us in the previous verses that all males are to appear before his face three times a year. Is this a coincidence? Or is he making a point of attaching this commandment to our appearing before his face three times per year for his three harvest feasts? He preceded this instruction, telling us in verse 25, you shall not sacrifice the blood of my sacrifice with leaven, neither shall the sacrifice of the feast of the Passover be left unto the morning. These two instructions follow him telling us to appear before his face three times per year. Understanding these two instructions begins with understanding his Passover instructions and his Feast of Unleavened Bread instructions. In Exodus chapter 12, Kikweh tells us that his Passover memorial, that is to be eaten during the night of the 14th day of the first month, is to be eaten with unleavened bread. The blood of his sacrifice refers to his Passover memorial. Not eating this sacrifice with leaven is symbolic of us getting rid of all leavening from our lives, or getting rid of all of that which causes us to be lifted up in pride and in arrogance before we are atoned for by his only begotten Son's shed blood. He commands us to observe this memorial each year as a memorial of his sacrifice unto us that he set up through his only begotten Son. But the feast of the Passover does not start until the next day. On the first night of this feast, the night of the 15th day of the first month, the night that our ancestors came out from Egypt, we are to do the night that is to be much observed. The proof of this is discussed in other videos. The second part of this verse is for his feast of the Passover on the night to be much observed. However, elsewhere he also commands us to not leave any of his Passover memorial until the morning. We are to burn up that which remains both of these nights before the morning comes upon us. This parallels the morning of the following prophecy, found in Hosea chapter 6. Come and turn back to Kikweh, because he has torn you in pieces, but he will heal you. He has smitten you, but he will bind you up. In 2 days, he will keep you alive. He's referring to keeping you alive through two particular days of the time of trouble that he is going to send upon the inhabitants of the world at this time. And in the third day, he will raise you up, and you will live before his face. And you will know how to pursue Yahweh. You will know how to pursue his righteousness, and you will know him, so that you will no longer play the whore to him. His going out, or his exit from the captivity of Mystery Babylon, is established in the dawning of the day, and he will come to you as the rain, as the latter and the former rain come to the earth. The Most High wove a parallel of these 3 days into the first 7 days of the great and the fearful day of Yahweh. He did so by mirroring them into the timing of the fourth blood moon. Therefore, I think that they are referring to the first 3 days of the final 7 days of the great and the fearful day of his wrath. However, there are other similar 3-day windows that will precede these 7 days. Whenever they are does not matter. What matters is you have the opportunity to hearken to the voice that he has sent to you now, so that you can come under his wings of his protection before then. Yahweh commands us to not seethe the Passover memorial lamb or goat in water. This is recorded in Exodus chapter 12, verse 9. However, he specifically tells us to seethe the sacrifices for the feast of the Passover that are lifted up to him on the night of the appointed time that he brought our ancestors forth from Egypt. This is recorded in Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 7. In this verse, the King James translator said that we are to roast this night's sacrifices, but this is a mistranslation. It is the same Hebrew word that means to seethe, and they knew this. They translated this word properly just 2 chapters earlier in verse 21 of chapter 14. This is the third place that he tells us to not seethe a kid of the goats in its mother's milk. The reason why they translated this word this way in Deuteronomy chapter 16 is because they did not understand the difference between his Passover memorial and the first night of the feast of the Passover, and they did not know how to deal with this difference in his instructions. There are other differences in his instructions for these two nights as well. For instance, we are not to leave our houses on the night of his Passover memorial. However, we are to not return back to our houses until the morning after the night to be much observed. Another difference between them is his Passover memorial is only to be of the flock, meaning either a lamb or a goat. However, the feast of the Passover can also be of the herd, meaning of the cattle. In lieu of the timing of which Yahweh tells us to not seethe a kid of the goats, right after he tells us to appear, all males to appear before his face 3 times per year in these 2 places in Exodus, what is the meaning of this association? And immediately after the third time that he gives us this instruction, he does the same. He associates it with appearing before his face 3 times per year. I'll expand on this third time in a bit. There is obviously significance of his doing so. It is after he tells us to not sacrifice the blood of his Passover sacrifice with leaven and to not leave the sacrifice of the feast of the Passover until morning that he tells us in verse 26, you shall go to Yahweh Elohim's house with the first of the firstfruits of your land, and you shall not seethe a kid in its mother's milk. There is a purpose in him paralleling this instruction with his instructions for all males to appear before his face 3 times per year and to bring him the first of our firstfruits to his house. The second time that he gave his servant Moses this instruction was when Moses was up on the mount the second time. In the next verse, he tells us in verse 27, and Yahweh said to his servant that he drew out from the water, I write to you these words, because upon these words, my mouth has cut a covenant with you and with Israel. He was there with Yahweh 40 days and 40 nights, and he did neither eat bread nor drink water. And he, referred to Yahweh, wrote the words of the covenant and the 10 words upon the tables. I write to you these words, means that Yahweh also wrote his instruction that he gave to us in the previous verse upon the two stone tablets with his 10 words. Why did the Most High end that which he gave to his servant Moses when he had called him up the mount for the second 40 days and 40 nights with his instruction to not seed a kid of the goats in its mother's milk? Pondering upon this should blow your mind. Surely there is more to this than just seething a kid of the goats in its mother's milk. And for sure this instruction does not mean that we cannot eat or drink dairy products with meat in the same meal. The part about coming to his house with the first of our first fruits is easy to understand. The first of our first fruits refers to the first 10% of our increase. His instructions for this in Deuteronomy chapter 14 testify to this. But why this second part? Why does he associate not doing this with coming before his face 3 times per year, and specifically with not sacrificing the blood of his Passover memorial with leavening and not letting the sacrifice of the feast of the Passover remain until morning? Do you really think that something that is given to us at this monumental waypoint up on the mount is merely a matter of not cooking a kid of the goats in its mother's milk? I said that the third time that he brought forth this instruction was in Deuteronomy chapter 14. When he did, it was at the end of his clean and unclean food statutes. And this is recorded in Deuteronomy chapter 14. I'll start in verse 21. You shall not eat of any dead carcass or give it to the stranger that is in your gates to eat. You can sell it to a foreigner, because you are holy, or set apart people unto Yahweh Elohim. You shall not seethe a kid in its mother's milk. The King James translated this verse to say that you can give it to the stranger that is in your gates to eat, or sell it to the alien. But elsewhere we find out that this is not the case. In Leviticus chapter 17, we are told that if the stranger that is with us eats that which is already dead, that he is also unclean. His word tells us that he gave us one Torah for both Israel and those who sojourn with us. This is why we must let his word testify to itself. He goes on in verse 22, you shall diligently tithe, of all of the increase of your seed that the field brings forth year by year, and you shall eat before Yahweh Elohim's face in the place that he will choose to place his name there. The tenth of your grain, and of your wine, and of your oil, and of the firstborn of your herds, and of your flocks, in order that you will learn to fear Yahweh Elohim in all of your days. Like I said, the Most High associates his instruction to not see the kid of a goat in its mother's milk with coming before his face 3 times a year by paralleling this instruction with doing so all 3 times that he gives it to us. His commandment to not do so, following his clean and unclean food statutes with this instruction, is also significant. Therefore, this commandment also parallels doing so with eating that which is unclean in his eyes. He gave the testimony of his word to us, here a little, there a little. During his Feast of Huts this year, at the end of the 1,260 days of his 42-month witness against you, he placed circumstances in the place that he has placed his name that caused his camp to stop eating anything that is cooked with raw meat that is being seethed in water or in milk. This is because he showed me that when we seethe raw meat in water or in milk, it releases blood into the liquid. Therefore, it releases the blood into the foods that are being cooked in this liquid. Concerning eating the blood, his word tells us in Leviticus chapter 3, verse 17, and it is a perpetual statute for all of your generations and in all of your habitations that you do not eat any blood or the fat. He defines offering up the fat to him in the previous verses. He started commanding man to not eat the blood right after he opened the ark's door for his servant Noah and his family to come off of it. This was his first and only "you shall not do" that he gave to his servant Noah at this time. This is recorded in Genesis chapter 9, verse 4. The Most High's word places great significance upon our not doing so. In Leviticus chapter 17, verse 14, he tells us, "For the blood is the life of all flesh. The blood is his life. Say to the children of Israel, you shall not eat the blood of any flesh, because the life of all flesh is his blood, and all that eat of it shall be cut off." Cut off is cut off. The reason why the Most High tells us to not seethe a kid of a goat in its mother's milk in the same verses that he tells us to appear before his face is to put an emphasis on his magnification of this statute at this time. He gave us this instruction in the form of a parable because it was not meant to be understood until now. And he has woven a second magnification of this commandment into the here and the now as well. When he gave it to us in Exodus chapter 23, he not only accompanied his instruction to appear before his face three times a year, I read to you where he also went on in the following verses to tell us in verse 20, "Behold, I send my messenger before your face, and I will hedge about you in the way, and you will come to the place that I have prepared for you, prepared before you. Hedge about him and obey his voice, and do not grieve him, because I will not lift your rebellion, because my name is in his inward parts. Because if you will diligently obey or hearken to his voice, and do all that I speak to you through my messenger, then I will be an enemy unto your enemies, and I will besiege your afflictions. But you have not diligently hearkened, and you have grieved me in doing so." These instructions following him telling us to not seethe a goat in its mother's milk are not a coincidence. We are in the days of the second Exodus, and the Most High has sent me telling you, this is the way, walk in it. If you continue to refuse to do so, he is going to empower your enemies to bring you low. And the time of affliction that he is getting ready to let loose upon you is going to besiege you. The fact that our ancestors offered unto Yahweh abundantly and did so freely after his servant that he drew out from the water came down off of the mountain the second time is awesome. They did so because he put fear upon them. We are told that Yahweh caused his servant's face to shine brightly at that time. This is recorded in Exodus chapter 34. And it was that when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tables of his witness in Moses' hands, when he came down from the mount, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shined, as with rays shooting forth, if you look at how the Hebrew word, while he talked with them. And when Aaron and all of the children of Israel saw Moses and beheld that the skin of his face shined, they were afraid to come near to him. The reason why his servant Moses had to go up to the mount the second time was because when he came down the first time, he found them playing the whore to the Most High. The same is true now, even after the 1,260 days of his 42-month witness against you is over with. You continue to play the whore to the Most High by clapping your hands and singing praises to make-believe idolatrous images of who he is. Your doing so is no different than our ancestors doing so with the golden calf. The Most High is soon going to cause you to fear. I do not know how he is going to do so, but I do know that he is going to do so. This is because his word says that he is going to do so, and his word tells us that his word is going to prosper in his time for it to prosper. I'll put the second time that Yahweh spoke this instruction to us back up on the screen, found in Exodus chapter 34. "You shall not sacrifice the blood of my sacrifice with leaven, neither shall the sacrifice of the feast of the Passover be left unto the morning. You shall go to Yahweh Elohim's house with the first of the first fruits of your land, and you shall not seethe a kid in its mother's milk." I said there is a purpose in him paralleling this instruction with his instructions for all males to appear before his face three times per year and bringing him the first of our first fruits to his house. And there is. He has bid for you to not only hearken to his word that he has put upon my mouth, he has also bid for you to bring your tithes and your offerings to the place that he has placed his name at this time. He has also bid for you to bring the head of your separation to the same place, to the door of his dwelling place, the tent of his appointed times, and to offer it up to him with a basket of unleavened bread. Like I said, this second time that he gave his servant Moses this instruction was when Moses was up on the mount the second time. It was at the end of these second 40 days and 40 nights. Will the second 80-day period of time that follows his 42-month witness against you end with him causing great fear to be upon your faces? Or will this begin to happen before then? I do know that we have some very significant waypoints that will occur before then, like the first day of the 11th month. I'll speak about the significance of this date and the other waypoints that will occur before the first day of the first month in another video. Verse 27, and Yahweh said to his servant that he drew out from the water, I write to you these words because upon these words my mouth has cut a covenant with you and with Israel. What does he mean by this? Just by following his instructions to not see the kid in its mother's milk with this verse. And he was there with Yahweh 40 days and 40 nights, and he did neither eat bread nor drink water, and he wrote the words of the covenant and the 10 words upon the tables. Like I said, these verses show that his not seething a kid in its mother's milk instructions was the last commandment that he reiterated to his servant Moses the second time that he was up on the mount. Is it a coincidence that his first and only you shall not do commandment that he gave to his servant Noah after he opened the ark's door was to not eat the blood? This is a parallel of the first will be the last and the last will be the first. Is it a coincidence that he gave us this instruction three times? Is it a coincidence that he led his camp to stop eating food that is cooked with uncooked meat, that is seethed in liquid, in lieu of the importance of that he his word places upon not eating the blood? Nor is it a coincidence how he has tied this instruction with his Passover instruction that tells us to not seethe his Passover memorial in water? Like I said, his word tells us that this memorial is to be either of the sheep or the goats. When my family and I were fled to Greece, he provided a lamb for each of the two Passover memorials that we observed while there. However, since then, he has provided a kid of the goats for each of the three Passover memorials that we have observed since he spit me out here in the midst of the chief seat of the scattered descendants of Israel. Is this detail another coincidence? This is part of his second magnification of his commandment for us to not seethe a kid of the goats in its mother's milk. We have not seethed any of these three kids in water or in their mother's milk. We have weaned them from their mother's milk, and we have sacrificed them in the manner of his instructions to do so. We have separated them from their mother's milk 4 days prior to the 14th day of the 10th month, just like his word tells us to do. Has anyone else in the whole world observed this memorial in this manner for these past 3 years? I think not. Again, he parallels the three times that he gives us this instruction with his commandment for all males to appear before his face 3 times per year. And one of these 3 times is his Passover memorial that precedes his 7-day feast of unleavened bread. And concerning doing so, his word tells us in Deuteronomy chapter 16 in verse 16, 3 times in a year all males shall appear before Yahweh Elohim's face in the place that he shall choose, in the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and in the Feast of Weeks, referring to the Feast of Sevens, the feast is also called the Feast of First Fruits, and in the Feast of Temporary Dwellings, he also refers to as the Feast of Ingatherings. And they shall not appear before Yahweh's face empty. The gift of each man's hand according to the blessing that Yahweh has given to him. The second 80-day period from the end of Yahweh's 1,260-day witness against Israel will end 13 days prior to his Passover memorial and 14 days prior to the first day of his Feast of the Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread. The significance of these numbers is discussed in other videos. If you think that this camp is not where he has placed his name at this time, I suggest that you get busy trying to find out where it is. And when you do, You had better not show up before his face empty unless he has not blessed you with anything. There being three Passovers that have passed since him spitting me out of the great ocean traversing plain means that this will be the fourth Passover. This parallels the fourth blood moon and his four spirits that he has sent out, but that most of you have continued to reject. Since he has blessed the place that he has placed his name with goats at this time and not with sheep, it looks like the fourth Passover that we will be observing, according to his word, in the chief seat of the scattered descendants of Israel, will once again be with a kid of the goats. How this parallels things like the recent four blood moons that he has sent in his warning cry is awesome. And once again, we will separate this kid from its mother's milk 4 days in advance, and we will not seethe him. We will roast him over fire, just like his word tells us to do. Thus saith his word that is upon his servant that dwells in the place that he has placed his name.